Day Street Books and Harper Audio present Life's Too Short, a memoir by Darius Rucker with Alan Eisenstock. This is Darius Rucker. In memory of my mother, Carolyn, who always encouraged me to sing, and for my family, who means everything to me, life's too short, get to living. I've been lost, I've been found. I've left my mark on my little bitty town. If I ever get to heaven, I'm gonna have a story to tell. Got some parts gonna make you laugh, some parts gonna make you cry, some pages I wish I could tear out. But I ain't gonna lie, because it's the story of my life. Story to Tell, Darius Rucker, Ross Copperman, Ashley Gourley. Introduction, Pieces of My Life, Elvis Presley. Music. Seems obvious, I suppose, but when I think about my life, telling my story, that's what it's all about. From the beginning until now, the music. Not the fame or the fun or the crowds or the career or the sex, drink, drugs, and money. No, the music. In fact, if I look back at my life and I try to see into my past, everything seems blurry. At least at first. I have to squint and blink away the haze so I can visualize the events that shaped me and the people who meant so much to me. I start to see clearly the people who swept through my life, for better or for worse. Most of them giving so much to me, a couple of them taking a part of me. At first, I don't really see them. I can't make out their faces. Then I lean in my past and I hear something, a sound begins, reverberating in my mind, faintly at first, then louder, and I realize what it is. Music. I start to hear it. It comes on, pours into me, songs. I hear the songs, the melodies, chords, harmonies, lyrics. Then as all those elements fill in, I start to hear something more. I begin to hear the stories that make up the songs, the stories that the songs tell. Gradually, everything starts to clear up. A fog lifts. I look back, and through the music, I can see. When I say look back, I'm talking way back. 50-plus years when I was a kid, man. A little kid. 4 years old. I started to hear the music then, that long ago. I heard the music loud and clear. I hear it now. I hear it always. The music would float around me, then flow into me, zap through my body like an electric charge and lift me. I would soar, I would fly. I'm 4 years old, sitting at our kitchen table, my head bent over, leaning into the radio, listening, even as I'm surrounded by other sounds, other voices, my mother, my grandmother, my sisters, my brother. But I wouldn't hear them. I wouldn't even be there. I would be someplace else. Lost in the music, devoured by the sound, transported by the songs. It's always, always about the music. Specifically certain songs, each one have a profound effect on me. To paraphrase the sage and soulful Ronnie Spector, each one of those songs is a little piece of my life. That's why I need to tell you my story through the songs that meant the most to me, the songs that coursed through my life, the songs that formed me, that took me higher, deeper, farther than any words, visual image, vision, or dream could take me. When a song hit me, my life stopped. I would hear a song at age 5 or 10 or 15 or 20, and I would listen to it, and that's all I would do for hours. Sometimes for days, I wouldn't just listen to the song. I would live that song. I would hear a song, and I would listen to it again and again and again. I would lose track of time, of space. I would become submerged in that song. The song would become my world. This book is about my life as told through those songs. Songs that took me away, starting at a ground level. Living in a poor but happy home, never wanting much more. Enjoying what I had, even when times got tough, because I had my escape, my refuge. I had my music, my songs. Songs that nobody else in my life could hear. At least not in the way I could. The songs would take me to places I could never dream. I would feel myself rising to heights I could never imagine. Daring myself to stare at the height and then go higher and higher and higher until I arrived at a place I never knew existed. I found myself flying, floating, and then after a while, I would start teetering and I would begin to fall. Then I'd plummet, end over end, hurtling back down, somehow barely preventing a headfirst crash into the earth. More than once, and then again, I'd envelop myself in and music. A song would rise and again the song would save me. What songs, what kind of music? Everything. An eclectic and surprising soundtrack, all different songs, different melodies, different genres, different styles. I lived inside my own personal playlist. Pop, country, rap, soul, rock. The Beatles, Stevie Wonder, Al Green, Frank Sinatra, R.E.M., Nancy Griffith, The Notorious B.I.G., Lou Reed, Kiss, Barry Manilow, and a whole bunch more. I listened to them all. They all formed me, molded me into the singer I became, into the person I am. The music was my pulse, my motor, my passion, my obsession, my religion. The songs were holy. The songs made me, me. I've picked out 23 songs for you, 23 essential songs. They're not in the exact order that I heard them or remember them, but pretty close. They all took me to a place I'd never been before. They transported me. They all meant the world to me. Even more, they all meant life. So please hear the music. Stand next to me. Clap your hands. Snap your fingers. Close your eyes. Hear my songs. Hear them with me. Lose yourself in them. Let them take you away. Let them take you home. Chapter 1. Drowning. Hootie and the Blowfish. It's 1998 or 1999. Not sure. I know it's at least 4 years since David Letterman made us a household name. And after Cracked Review shocked the music world, selling more than 1 million copies a month, and we'd ridden that rocket ship arriving on the planet ubiquitous, toured the world more than once, and then boom, kind of soft landing back to Earth. Still, everyone knows our name. Yeah, it's early 1999. Pretty sure, maybe. But as I say, time back then has gone kind of fuzzy. Well, a lot of stuff back then has gone fuzzy. When we were on the road, I spent most of my hours holed up with the guys, listening to music and smoking, snorting, or swallowing various reality-altering indulgences. Mushrooms, Molly, acid, to name a few. Nearly always accompanied by my close personal friend, Jim Beam. If I'm honest, I'll be completely honest. Hootie the Blowfish reigned supreme in two not altogether unrelated areas, selling records and doing drugs. One time a roadie, British guy who had worked with several rock and roll bands known for their contributions to music world, as well as their record-breaking drug consumption, stared at the mountain range of the snowy-peaked white powder we laid out on the table in front of us and said, "I've been around a lot of bands, and nobody comes close to you guys. Not close." Not sure if he was complimentary or amazed, I was too high to decide. Anyway, those days we played stadiums at night, night after night, and smoked and snorted and drank the rest of the time. We partied hard, all of us except Mark. For the rest of us, the party never stopped. Until it did. Along the way, I got tight with Woody Harrelson, fantastic actor. An even better human being, pot smoker supreme, major mushroom enjoyer, a beautiful guy. Not sure how we became friends. I think he came to a show. He popped in backstage after it and we hit it off. That's as much as we remember. Truth is, everybody wants to be friends with Woody. He's kind, generous, fun, and mellow. When I tell him that he's the mellowest guy I know, Woody takes that drumstick side joint I'm offering to him and says, "I'm not mellow, I'm just lazy as shit." Around this time, the band has released our third album, Musical Chairs. We've been touring nonstop on the road constantly. Finally coming to the last leg of back-to-back tour stops and I'm fried, I need a break. Woody lives in Hawaii, sees how stressed I am and invites me to hang out with him and chill. I've never been to Woody's house, but he's shown me pictures and massive palms and coconut trees lining his land, flowers and vegetation everywhere, a house with breathtaking views in every direction. He starts to describe some of the activities we'll enjoy, but I say yes before he can finish the sentence. I head to Hawaii, preparing to stay with Woody for 2 weeks. I'm not prepared for Woody's lifestyle. Woody lives in the middle of nowhere, far from any people. The house sits on a stunning piece of property, a flat, grassy pocket overlooking a series of cliffs. I might be jet-lagged or stoned, but inside his home, I don't see walls. Lots of open area views from every window above and below. And those cliffs, stunningly imposing, beautiful and straight down, the waves crashing, thundering below. The house itself isn't huge, maybe 2,000 square feet. That's because the main guest quarters are outside, and all over his wide yard, he set up several yurts. A yurt, I learned, is a tricked-out circular tent. The walls fashioned from cloth or canvas or maybe wool. I don't know. I don't care. I start to head into the house, but Woody stares me to his lawn, back to the yurts. "This is where all my guests stay, except you," he says, stopping at one of the largest yurts, grinning that famous infectious Woody smile. "Very comfortable. They don't stay in the house. This is better." "A fucking tent?" "No, man, a yurt. It's how the Mongolian people used to live. You hungry? I'm starving. Chill out here, man. I'll be right back with a snack." I check out the yurt. I look around at the accommodations. Blankets cover a low bed, a kind of futon. The yurt has running water, a bathroom, electricity, and furniture that's functional and comfortable. I've never been a fan of camping, but this yurt goes way beyond camping. It's almost luxurious, almost. A minute later, Woody arrives with a ceramic bowl filled with purple paste. He sits cross-legged on the blankets on the floor of the yurt. I join him. "Try this," he says. He dips his hand into the bowl, scoops out three fingers of the purple goo, and licks the gunk off. "Hits the spot," he says. "Offer me the bowl. Go for it." "I'm really not that hungry," I say. "It's poi. Try it." I do, reluctantly. The goo tastes like blueberry spackle. "Well, yum," I say. "It'll grow on you," Woody says. "I don't think so." So a heads up, we start every day with yoga, clothing optional, actually clothing discouraged. I take this in a nod, naked yoga. Yeah, first a group chat, then naked yoga, then a poi drink. I nod at the purple paste in the bowl. What do you think? Run this through a blender, pour it into a glass, and then drink it? Exactly, gotta flush out those toxins. Oh, and get used to it, no TV. I hear sound escape from my mouth, something between a whimper and a wail. "Man, you're stressed," he says. "A tad, yeah. I know what you need. Fire up a hooter." We head to the house, to my room, and we smoke a blunt the size of an eggplant. A few minutes, I'm mellow as hell. A few minutes after that, I'm conked out. I sleep for 12 hours. The next day, I give in to Woody's world. I get up at dawn and do co-ed naked yoga with Woody and a group of strangers. I drink my pasty purple poi drink. Woody and I take walks. We talk. We laugh, we play chess. I'm decent, Woody's a master. And yes, we smoke dope. For lunch every day, we eat salads made from the roots, flowers, fruit, and plants that his cook picks right from his garden off his tree. For a snack, we have poi. I don't love it, but I get used to it. For dinner, more salad. We never cook anything. We eat everything fresh and raw. A few days pass. I feel like I'm in some foreign land adjusting to the native customs, but you know what? I love it. I feel so relaxed. I feel different. I feel changed. One afternoon on a typically cloudless, crystal blue sky, slightly breezy, 70-degree day in paradise, Woody suggested we go swimming. A friend of his, Kirk, has recently taken up residence in one of the yurts, and Woody's invited him along. "All this chilling is great," Woody says, "but you got to get your blood up. At Woody's, if you want to go swimming, you don't simply slap on your trunks and dive into the pool. Way more complicated than that." We begin our swim by climbing down a jagged cliff very slowly and carefully, inch by inch, until after a treacherous 25-minute descent, we arrive at a sliver of beach tucked into a lip of sleepy-looking lagoon. We catch our breath as the water laps gently at our feet. Yeah, shading my eyes with my hand, I peer at the small strip of land in the distance. "What's that, Woody?" "That's where we're going. It's a little island." "Cool," I say. I step into the water. "Wow, this is like bath water." "It is. And it's so calm." "It isn't." I look at him. "Are you a good swimmer?" Woody asks. "Pretty decent, yeah. Here's the deal. We're going straight out to that island, dive in and swim out. That's all you got to do. Go straight. That's a main thing. Make sure you go straight. Because if you swim toward the beach or the rocks, you'll get caught in the current, and it'll take you to the rocks, and you'll be fucked." I cock my head toward Woody. This is by far the longest and most pointed speech he's ever given me. I keep staring at him. "Darius, you hear me?" "Yeah. Stay out of the current, man. Swim straight out, okay?" "Okay, yeah, I got you." Whap, splash. Woody and Kirk dive in side by side, slicing through the water together like a pair of synchronized swimmers. I hesitate a half second, and then I dive right in behind them. At least I think I do. I begin swimming, and in all modesty, I'm a better than decent swimmer. I'm a strong, confident swimmer. I was born and raised in South Carolina, home to some of the best beaches in the country. Hilton Head, Kiawah Island, Sullivan's Island, Folly Beach. I know them all. I swam at them all. I know my way around a beach. I cut through the water, swimming powerfully, heading straight out, is what he said. But as I swim straight ahead, I swear I'm going straight ahead. I start to feel disoriented. I don't see Woody or Kirk, and I don't see the small island that's supposed to be in front of me. I don't see anything. I keep swimming straight, but all I see is water everywhere.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.